Tidings of comfort and joy. We are certainly grateful to God for giving the gift of His Son, that He might bring us tidings of comfort and joy. Certainly to pass the page, and as I sat there listening to him doing his presentation, I know that he had asked me about preaching this morning, but as I listened to him, I was beginning to wonder who he was talking about. Certainly we are grateful to him for extending to us this privilege, this opportunity, and this honor to be at home and to share with the family on this morning. Certainly to Minister Relford, Reverend Smith, Minister Payne. Good to see you, my brother. Bless you. Bless you to the deacons, officers, members of Pleasant Green, and certainly to my wife hanging out on the back row. So that she can make her escape when the time comes to start with the recipe cookbooks. Amen, amen. It's certainly good to be here, and someone has said it's good to be anywhere and know it. We certainly thank God for another day, for looking beyond our many faults and failures, and blessing us to see this day. If we would all confess the truth, none of us deserve to be here. But it's because of God's grace, His mercy, and His love that we've been spared to be here on today. And we ought to be, if we're not, we ought to be truly grateful. If you would just excuse me for a moment, I need to get a little help in here, Brother Jay. I know you're a catch on, I won't tell you what note. Because they are 26 alphabets. So you just listen and see which one of the 26 I start out on. And if you would just pick that one, catch me on that one. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Oh, By you. Please think with my mind. Please love with my heart. And please speak with my tongue. That your word would go forth and accomplish that which you sent it forth to do. Please hide me now behind the shadow of the cross of Calvary. That your people would see none of me, but all of thee. Yes, that the name of Jesus Christ may be glorified, and that the body of Christ may be edified. We gladly give your name the glory, the honor, and the praise. In Jesus' name, we pray and give thanks. Amen. Amen. We would like to prayerfully call your attention to the second recorded letter to the Corinthians, chapter 12, verses 1 through 10. That's Paul's letter to the Corinthians, the second recorded letter, chapter 12, verses 1 through verse 10. And I will be reading from the Living Bible translation for clarity and understanding. And it reads, this boasting will do no good, but I must go on. I will reluctantly tell about visions and revelations from the Lord. I was caught up to the third heaven 14 years ago. Whether I was in my body or out of my body, I don't know. Only God knows.
Amen.
Yes, only God knows whether I was in my body or outside my body. But I do know that I was caught up to paradise and heard things so astounding that they cannot be expressed in words. Things no man, human, is allowed to tell. That experience is worth boasting about, but I'm not going to do it. I will boast only about my weakness. If I wanted to boast, I would be no fool in doing so, because I would be telling the truth. But I won't do it, because I don't want anyone to give me credit beyond what they can see in my life or hear in my message. Even though I have received such wonderful revelations from God, So to keep me from becoming proud, I was given a thorn in the flesh, a messenger from Satan to torment me and keep me from becoming proud. Three different times, I begged the Lord to take it away. Each time he said, "My grace is all you need. My power works best in weakness." So now, I am glad to boast about my weaknesses so that the power of Christ can work through me. That's why I take pleasure in my weaknesses and in the insults, hardships, persecutions, and troubles that I suffer for Christ. For when I am weak, then I am strong. We would like to use for an offer your prayer for consideration the sufficiency of God's grace. The sufficiency of God's grace. If we were to talk and say all that can be said about God's grace, all of the lifespans of all who have been born and all who will be born would not give us enough time to talk about God's grace in its entirety. So today we would like to take a glimpse of grace and just take a glimpse of what we find in the Word of God about God's grace. As Paul writes this letter here, we understand that Paul is writing this letter in defense of his apostleship. Because there are those who are saying that Paul is not all he says that he is. Right. Paul writes this letter to the Corinthians because while he is away, those who call themselves super apostles have crept into the church. And because they are feeding the church of God false doctrines and false teachings, Paul finds it necessary to write this letter to defend himself because they are contradicting everything that Paul has taught the church at Corinth. They're even going so far as to say that Paul, if you will, is a jackleg apostle. That he is not the real deal. And that they are the real true apostles. So Paul writes this letter to defend his apostleship because he wants the church at Corinth to understand and to know that the word that he gave them, the gospel message that he gave them, is not something that he cooked up or came up with. But the message that he delivered to them was given to him by the Lord himself. So Jesus has commissioned Paul to be the apostle to the Gentiles. And in this apostleship, there are those who would try to undermine what Paul is doing for the Lord. Don't be alarmed when you try to give your best in service to the Lord. And there are those who try to undermine your ministry. There are those who try to dig ditches for you in order that you might stumble and fall in because they are jealous of what God has given to you. You just go ahead on and give God your best. And if you give God your best, God will bless your ministry. You see, man cannot stop what God has put in motion. No matter how hard he tries, he cannot stop God's word and God's will. God's will be done in earth as it is he finds himself writing this letter, and he thinks about how all that God has shown him. And as he looks at what God has shown him, the different visions and revelations, Paul looks at how he can write this letter to reaffirm and to affirm his apostleship. So he looks at this vision that he had 14 years ago and how he had been taken up into paradise and how God has shown him things and how God has revealed things unto him that he says that no human could tell of. So Paul can't use what God has shown him to prove or to validate his apostleship. So Paul looks and say, well, what is it that I can tell the church at Corinth about that will help validate my apostleship? So Paul has prayed to the Lord now because of the fact he wants to tell them about what he's seen. But since God doesn't want it to be told, he gives him a thorn in the flesh. You know, every once in a while, God has to give us something to remind us who he is. And he gave Paul a thorn in the flesh, this messenger from Satan, in order to remind him of who God is. Paul said that he prayed three times. I'd like to suggest he prayed one time for the Father, one time for the Son, one time for the Holy Spirit. You see, he prays this triune prayer to a triune God. And each time he got the same answer from the Lord, saying, my grace is sufficient for you. My grace is all you need. For you see, my power is made perfect in weakness. Paul wants us to understand and to know that it is in our weakness that God does his best work. He said, as long as you're trying to do things in your power, trying to do it under your own strength, God stands on the sideline and watch you do what you think you can do. And then when you arrive at the point of confessing to the Lord, I can't make it by myself. I can't make it on my own. Lord, I need your help. That's when the Lord steps in. I found out he is a God that steps in just on time. You see, he's never been late. He's never been early. He's always right on time. He's an on-time God. Yes, he is. He's an on-time God. Yes, he is. He may not come when you want him, but he's always right in the nick of time. And I'm glad he's in the nick of time, God, because when I give up, when I give in, he shows up just in time. He picks me up and lifts me up and strengthens and empowers me for the task he's assigned unto me. Paul looks at it and he says, well, what then can I use to validate my apostleship? Paul says, so I am glad to boast about my weakness. And as he says, because he's glad to boast about our weakness, I'd like to suggest that Paul encouraged us to remember three things. Number one, Paul says that because of my weakness, I don't have to fake it. You see, because of the sufficiency of God's grace, I don't have to fake it. You see, the reason why I don't have to fake it is because God knows my weakness. And when I know my weakness and I confess my weakness, I don't have to fake it. Because along and come into the world of reality and you realize what is what is and what ain't is what ain't, then you won't have to be a fake with yourself, not a fake with others, and you show enough can't fake God. Yeah, you don't have to fake it when you acknowledge your weakness. Well, when you acknowledge your weakness, not only do you not have to fake it because God's grace is sufficient, but also you discover that you can make it. You see, when you confess your weakness to God, and you confess your weakness to yourself, and you confess that you can't make it by yourself, God will help you when you just confess your weakness to Him. You see, God knows our weakness. So since He already knows it, we might as well confess it. And stop spinning your wheels, going nowhere. You know, when you are jogging in place, you are making a lot of movement, but you're not going anywhere. And unfortunately, there are too many folks trying to fake it who are jogging in place in this Christian walk of life, and all you're doing is using up energy, wasting energy, and going nowhere. If you want to go somewhere, stop faking it, and then the Lord will help you to make it. No matter what your weakness is, God can help you in your weakness if you just turn it over to the Lord. Paul says that he said to Paul that my grace is all you need. You don't have to worry about the grace of other folks. God's grace is sufficient. I've discovered that when folks close doors in your face, God's grace is sufficient because God's grace will open closed doors. God can make a way out of no way. But not only can He make a way out of no way, I've discovered that God will make a way anyway. In spite of you and me, He will still make a way. Well, not only you don't have to fake it, you can take it, but I'd like to suggest to you that you can also make it. Because when you have the Lord on your side, everything you need, God's got it. My Bible tells me that God shall supply all your needs according to His riches and glory through Christ Jesus. Now, if God's going to supply all my needs, the last time I checked the dictionary, A-L-L all didn't leave out any or none. Now, I know they might have changed the definition with some of this new vocabulary they're coming out with these days, but the last time I checked with Webster, they hadn't changed the definition of all yet. So whatever I need, I know where to go to get my needs met. You see, some of us mess up when we're in need, and we start to thinking about where we can go and who we can go to meet our needs. When we go and get there, we discover that they in need too. So why try to go to resources when you can go to the source of all resources? When you take it to the Lord and you leave it there, I guarantee you that the Lord will give you what you need. Now, He might not give you what you want, but He'll give you what you need. Paul prayed three times to get what he wanted, because he wanted the thorn removed. But the Lord said, Paul, I hear you pray. I know you want this thorn removed from you, but you don't understand, Paul. You need this thorn. And because you need the thorn, I'm going to say no, Paul, to your prayer. Sometimes when we pray, we have to remember that God sometimes says no. He says no to us because he knows what we need in spite of what we want. You see, we go to God with our bucket list, things we want him to take care of for us. But you see, God is not a bellhop, one that you can just ring the bell and he'll show up and take care of your baggage and your luggage for you. You see, God is a God who, when you call on him, we have to be earnest and sincere in our request to him. For my Bible tells me to let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard your heart. But not only will it guard your heart, he'll guard your mind in perfect peace. And when you have God's perfect peace, no matter what your weakness is, if you have God's perfect peace, you'll be all right with God's perfect peace. You see, God has a peace that the world can't give. God has a peace that the world can't take away. And if you just call on the name of the Lord, he will show up. Not only will he show up, I'm glad that he's the kind of God that when he shows up, he doesn't show up empty-handed. But he shows up with his hands full of blessings, just waiting on us to be obedient to his word, be obedient to his will. And the Lord will bless you right in the nick of time. If you just call on him, he's listening, waiting on his children to cry and to call in order that he might answer our prayer. God's grace is sufficient. And because of the sufficiency of God's grace, Paul says that in my weaknesses, I can handle the insults. Because of my weakness, I depend on the Lord's strength and not my strength. And insults do come. If you've ever been insulted yet, just keep on waking up in the morning. Your insult is on the way. And when insults do come, Paul says that I can take it because of the strength that I have in the Lord. But he says, not only do insults come, but he says hardships come. And in my weakness, I can take the hardships. Haven't had any yet? Just let this government that we have in place get the laws passed that they want to get passed. If you are in the middle class, and I believe most of us in here will probably fall into the middle class. If you're in the middle class, get ready for your hardships, because your hardships are on the way. And like I told Paradise last Sunday, you're going to have to learn how to make it on broken pieces. You see, you're going to have to learn how to take a little knot and how to stretch it and how to make it last. Like back in the day when our ancestors had little or nothing, they could take little or nothing and stretch it and make it last all month long. You know, when I was growing up, I learned how to make it on broken pieces. You see, my family, my parents provided our needs, but they didn't provide our wants. And when I wanted a bicycle, what I learned how to do is how you can take an old piece of bicycle and you go around and find another piece of bicycle. And you can take a piece off of that bicycle, put it on the other bicycle, and then find another piece of bicycle and get some handlebars off of it and put it on the first piece of bicycle. And if you keep on looking, you'll find another piece of bicycle. Take the chains off of that piece of bicycle. Put it on the first piece of bicycle. Keep on looking. Find another piece of bicycle. Take the seat off of that piece of bicycle. myself. Put it on the first piece of myself. Keep on looking, find another piece of myself. Take the barrels off that piece of myself. Put it on the first piece of myself. Keep on looking, find another piece of myself. Take the fender off that piece of myself. Put it on the first piece of myself. And when you get through piecing the pieces together, you'll have a whole myself. Just keep on living. Keep on waking up. You're gonna discover that what you had, you don't have no more. You have to learn how to make it on broken pieces. But I discovered when you know God as your personal Savior, His grace is sufficient, and you can make it on broken pieces. Just hang on in there. Thank you.